If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump,
yes,
we had the Box and Burn boys here.
Our favorite English fellows.
They are, they've got a great podcast. They've got a great, two great gyms now in Southern California, boxing, cardio, fitness. And they're also hosting certification courses for trainers.
Yeah, they're going to do it right here at our facility.
At our facility. Actually, they are. They're going to be hosting one at our facility. But it's cool because you get units, right, for different certifications.
CUs, yeah.
Yeah, for like NASM, I know, was one of them. ISSA, I forgot the other one. AFA is the other one. We had great conversations with these guys. The following episode, we talk a lot about fitness business.
It's the business end of things.
Yes. So if you're in the fitness industry, if you're a trainer, or if you're thinking about pursuing a business in fitness, this is a very informative episode. Really dive deep into their business and what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And of course, we talk about their boxing certification and what that entails and why it's different from other boxing certifications. And of course, like Justin said, we are hosting one of their certifications here October 8th.
Yes. I believe we might have actually said 7th in the episode, but it is the 8th. It's a Sunday, so plan on that. Mark that in your calendar.
And you can come here to Mind Pump Media Studios and do your course here. And it's taught by the Olympian, Tony Jeffries, and of course his partners, Glenn Holmes and Kevan Watson, who are the guys that are going to be on this episode you're about to listen to right now. Now, if you want to sign up for the certification, it is limited space. As of the recording of this intro, there's only 8 spaces left. They only have 30 people per class.
Hurry the hell up is what we're trying to get at.
To sign up, you go to Box and Burn Academy. That's Box, B-O-X, the letter N, burnacademy.com. It's going to be here October 8th in San Jose, at Mind Pump Media headquarters. And if you use the code MINDPUMP, you'll get $100 off.
And that code is only good for 48 hours.
Oh, shoot. There you go. 48 hours and it's done. So when this episode drops, that's it. 48 hours and then it's no good. So without any further ado, here we are talking to Tony Jeffries, Glenn Holmes, and Kevan Watson.
I want to talk about, you did a post like maybe a couple of weeks ago about another great fitness mind that you had on your show, and you actually said that their episode was better than ours, so I have a bone to pick with you.
Yeah,
about that.
Oh, man.
I want to get to the bottom of this right now.
Yeah, how come we're not your favorite?
Who the fuck is this guy, and I wanted to, how did he actually have a better episode than us?
Alan Crosgrove, he was talking more about the business side, putting systems in place, where when we come on here last, he's never told me about that. Well, you should have told us about that.
I know. That's not fair, dude. We were so caught up in the science bullshit, we didn't get to talk about the money stuff. Like, I mean, all you had to say, let's go that way.
You got to start with step one.
Yeah.
You start with step one, and then you move.
Know what you're doing, right? Then make money. So give me some stuff that he shared with you. I mean,
yeah, it was kind of telling us about the philosophy of what McDonald's use with the systems. He says you wouldn't go in McDonald's on a Tuesday because Peter's there and Peter makes great fries, nor the fries are the same on every day of the week. And that comes down to the systems that they've got in place, you know, to make them. So, and it's kind of the same with receptionists at work. That's what we use for the example. Like, every time someone comes in, they need to be greeted the same, you know,
The counterpoint I had to that was for reception and front desk and all that. It's a great point, but with trainers and classes and fitness in general, it's a very creative industry, and you've got to allow creative freedom with the trainers while still maintaining a system. So it's finding that fine line where you're giving trainers creativity, but you've still got to do that within the system.
Absolutely correct. Having managed big gyms as part of a large chain, you definitely want to have systems that makes people know that they're going to walk in and get what they're going to expect, right?
Yeah.
It's a certain look, a certain feel, there's classes, the greeting is the same. However, that personal connection with trainers, you don't want to stifle that creativity from the trainer.
Right.
Because I've experienced this where the company decided everybody has to do everything exactly the same, and it killed their business because they lost that. They lost that ability. So it's kind of a fine, line that you got to kind of, dance
but
around.
If we've created a class, like which we have, an amazing class, and a trainer's got a good idea for that class, he can't just implement that idea in the class and see, oh, now we're doing 4 minute rounds because this is better. If that idea is better, he's got to come to us and say, listen, I think this idea is better. And then if we all agree and we're all on the same page, then we'll put that across all classes.
It's a tough one because on the one hand, you want to do that. But on the other hand, you know, perhaps you have 10 trainers and they're all good, by the way. So we're not talking about people who are shitty versus, they're all good trainers. Mm-hmm. But you've got 10 potential laboratories of a little bit of experiment with a little bit of different creativity to where you give them enough autonomy to where they feel that they can be a little creative. And then you're going to get, that's how you're going to see what is really working. Be like, that right there is freaking awesome.
Yeah.
This doesn't work, so I'm going to tell you to stop doing that. But this is amazing. Let's see if we can duplicate that. And you want to be careful because you might stifle that.
Well, you guys are embarking on probably one of the probably hardest things that someone can do when they start to branch out and they have multiple facilities and then franchise in a sense, like McDonald's or whatever, right? And most guys that have built empires that are big like this will tell you that they miss the good days when they were building it at the beginning, because what ends up happening is so much of your energy and focus gets put into these systems, you know, because it becomes important. Like, you're right. Like, you know, a great book to read is the Starbucks book. I forget what it's called. Also, Fred Factor for Your Front Desk. So Fred Factor for Your Front Desk, the Starbucks book is really good because they did such a great job of doing that. Like, you can get a cup of Starbucks anywhere in the world and you can guarantee that it's going to consistently taste that way. And that is definitely kudos to them and their systems that they put in place, and everything too, like how the girl, you know, takes your order and how she talks to you, all that. I mean,
the other thing to consider too is,
but you lose the magical little piece to it where it's unique and different and, you know, allows all this freedom and flexibility and different brilliant minds to kind of blossom and be their own. What ends up happening, and this is what I didn't like about working for a big corporation, was to be on, and I forget what book this is, it talks about this, is how big corporations really don't want A players. We pretend like that we want A players, but we really want, you know, B minus C players, people that
just do as they're told.
Yeah, do as they're told. Because if you really surrounded yourself with a bunch of A personalities like yourself, those guys and girls don't stay around for very long because they eventually want to do big things like you did, right? So it's this fine line of finding the right people, right, that fit in that category of, you know, I need guys and girls that can execute, can do great things for us, but I actually only want them to be so good, or knowing that I'm gonna develop them, I'm gonna get the most I can while they're here, knowing that they're gonna exit and leave one day from me, right?
I think personal trainers by nature, at least good personal trainers, are very creative people. In a sense, they're artists. So like, if you take that ability for them to be creative within, you know, whatever it is that you're trying to build with the fitness facility, it is going to be very destructive. But I think our model is great because, yeah, we have the structure, we have the 9 rounds, we have the warm up, we have the shadow boxing, we have the burnout. But within those rounds, there's a platform that for them to kind of sprinkle their own flavor in and really do what it is they do and what they, you know, what their strengths are.
Yeah, and the other thing too with retail, you know, when you want a Starbucks or a McDonald's and you travel around the world, you're going to go in, you're going to walk in, you're going to get your product and leave. Mm-hmm. When it comes to fitness, when you look at the statistics, a very small percentage of people exercise when they travel. It's actually a small percentage. Most people work out when they're home. Mm-hmm. So the benefit of being exactly the same everywhere, you lose a little bit of that with fitness. It's not necessarily the same, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
Whereas if I'm traveling, I'm going to still get a Starbucks if I'm in a different state or a different country. I may not be like, hey, I'm on my vacation for a week, I want to go find the gym that I always work out at. It doesn't typically transfer that way.
I think what's so brilliant about your guys' model is that you have the classes, but then you also have these little mini gyms attached to it that allows. So what I would do is I would encourage my trainers to, you know, you fucking follow the protocol that we built, you know, that's in there for a reason. And we can discuss about potentially modifying in the future and all agree upon if that's a good idea. But where you have your creativity is in your private sessions.
Yeah,
exactly. You know what I'm saying? Like, be creative. Do unique things. You think 4 rounds is great? Well, fucking do it when you're teaching your little class.
Yeah,
you know what
I'm saying? Exactly what we're trying to do. You know, we've spent years, 5 years now on trying to perfect our class. Obviously, it's not perfect and it's not it's not amazing yet, but it's still one of the best workouts you're going to get within a boxing class. Mm. See, we have 5 to 7 trainers teaching one class. We've tried just about most things to make it better. We've done loads of trial and error. So if a trainer comes in and they're like, nah, this is better today, mm. we're going to do this. Like, if you do go to McDonald's, someone's not going to put triple cheese on your burger if it's a double cheeseburger because he thinks it's better.
Mm. Right.
You know, if he does think it's better, he's going to go and tell the managers, or listen, I think if we put 3 cheeses sure. on this, it's going to be better. And then if it is better, let's do it across everything.
Have you identified what makes some of your trainers more popular than others? Have you identified some of those things?
Glenn, he's really good looking.
Yeah.
No, I think it's what makes it is energy.
Passion.
Passion, yeah, energy.
It really comes down to passion and genuine care about, you know, what it is they do and helping people. And then, you know, a sincere sense of, what's the word? Just a sincere sense to always want to get better and mm-hmm. continue to improve, and consistency is a big thing.
How do you train?
Wait, before you go there, because what I want to know, it'll help everybody who's listening and watching this too, is what are each of you kind of responsible for the business? Like, what do you each kind of focus on the most? Like, is someone heading up the trainers most? One guy's looking more business vision and the financials? Isn't it like, what are each of your main roles in the growth of the business or the focus?
Yeah, Kev's put together a trainer development program now, like a hiring system. At one time, we used to hire people like, oh, have you done boxing before yet? Can you hold the pads? Great, you're hired. That's it. That was kind of it because we grew that fast and we needed that many trainers. But now he's put this system together that's really good, where before we even interview a trainer, we tell them, come and take some classes, try the classes out, tell us if it's for you or not. Then we want you to write some notes about the class. How can we benefit having you working for us?
Hmm. Where do they fit in within like what we do? And can they see themselves fitting here? And is it something they see themselves doing?
Yeah, then from there, then we'll interview them. So they've got to go through. So that tells us whether they want to be in this industry or not. Because in LA, more than anywhere, people want to be actors, actresses, models, whatever, and they're not passionate about this. Mm. So just that there, we can tell if they're passionate about it or not. Then we get them in for the interview. If the interview goes well, then we put them on a trainer development program what Kev's put together. So they've got to go through this long process just before they kind of get the foot in the door. Then we do some development stuff with them to see if they're ready for classes. Once they're ready for classes, then we put them on the classes, starting to shadow them. Then we start paying them because they don't earn any money up to this. It might take 2 weeks, it might take a month, it might take 2 months before they're ready for this process.
And then who's managing the trainers like day to day? Like who's handling that? Like
yeah, and then from there, once they get on the classes and all that, then we've got head trainers. Like Glenn is like the fitness director and he overlooks all the trainers. And the performance. We've got another trainer, Stephen, who's helping with the performance as well of the trainers. Because, like I said, we've got 30 trainers, so it's a big thing. The hardest thing is in business is managing people, mm-hmm. being a leader, and it's tough.
It's interesting what you said at the beginning. How when people used to walk in at the beginning, it was like we needed them more than they needed us, really. Because, mm-hmm. like Tony said, we grew so quick; the classes were packed. We just needed manpower. But now, fast forward 5 years, we've built up a reputation and built the brand well enough, and the membership's solid, and the gyms are busy, the classes are full. Now we can be way more selective in the process and start hiring better talent to help it grow even better.
Is the new hiring process, have you found it now to be more successful, where you have less turnover, or is it?
Yeah, I mean, I think we've definitely had some real, like, tangible success with it. You know, we're really only about 3 or 4 months in, and we've really only had a handful of those trainers go through that whole process. It's tough because it's like, okay, well, you could potentially lose out on some great talent if you really extend this hiring process, you know, to 2 months, because people need to make money mm-hmm. quickly. So, but you know, by extending it, you really kind of weed out those people that don't sure. have the initiative and don't really have the genuine passion about even doing sure. it. So that, you know, we just by doing that, we do weed out a lot of, yeah. you know, people that otherwise may have had an opportunity and then they end up leaving a month later.
Yeah, no, the big issue yeah. isn't necessarily that you're going to lose people because the process takes too long, although that may happen.
Yeah.
And like you said, those probably are people you wouldn't want anyway.
Exactly.
The real issue is this time and money that we're investing in this process yeah. worth it?
Yeah.
Because I've worked for, you know, companies that, you know, they actually analyzed their whole process where mm-hmm. they did this whole long like interview process, and then they found that they only improved their turnover rate by like 2%. It wasn't even worth, you know. Wow. Yeah, and then other times there's other, you know, other techniques and strategies.
October 7th is when you guys come here, right?
Yeah.
So October 7th, you guys are hosting a certification here in our facility. And, you know, that doesn't mean you're necessarily going to be trainers that work for you guys. This could be just trainers that are looking for CEUs or trying to, you know, add boxing into their weapon. Is that a CEUs for NASM?
Yeah. For a point, there's like three or four.
Nice. Okay, so it even goes, to, which is awesome. Mm-hmm. It goes for ACE, NASM. So you can be just...
I guess one other.
Yeah.
So you could just be a trainer who's looking for the education piece, but then you could also potentially be looking for... candidates that could be trainers for you guys at one point. Is that right?
Do you select some of these trainers that come through? I know.
I guess Eddie came from Austin, but he was moving to LA anyways. But most of the trainers that we have that work for us now that have come from the academy, it's all been local, like Santa Monica academies. But, you know, for the most part, the trainers that we see in these satellite academies, you know, they're just looking to kind of add the boxing training to their catalog of knowledge to work with their trainers. Because everyone that does personal training these days wants to know how to box and how to
hold pads correctly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, we are seeing a lot of interest for that from personal trainers specifically.
Oh, what? Definitely. Yeah.
That's good.
A huge side bonus of all this as well is like what we said when we do our courses in Santa Monica, it's almost like an audition because they're coming. We're getting like 30, 40 personal trainers coming in the gym and then – we can pretty much take our pick and see like, oh, he's good. And then they're interested in working in the gym too.
He's charismatic. So she's charismatic.
It's ended up being kind of like a good little recruiting tool at the same time.
Are there many women that join these classes and are super into it? Because I know when I was training some of my clients, like my female clients were super into boxing. Are you seeing a lot of interest in that?
Oh, huge.
Yeah, the women love it, you know.
And what's your ratio? How many girls in the classes? More
in
guys,
the classes,
more girls?
It's probably like 70% females at the boxing fitness classes.
60-70%, yeah.
But at the certification courses, that's different. It's probably 50-50. Yeah. But a great thing about this is teaching boxing, it's really good for keeping your clients, retaining your clients, because every time you do a boxing session, we've done some early on with Justin, I've done some before him, every time you do boxing, you get better. Each session, you can see a big improvement. So mentally, that's good for your clients. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? And they get great results, obviously, because it's a full body workout and all that. So we're getting people telling us, like, now it sounds like a cheesy sales pitch, but it's not. But they're earning more money because they're retaining more clients. They're putting boxing classes on in their gym through coming to our course and learning how to teach boxing.
Every one of my top trainers held pads.
Really?
Yeah. All the clubs I've ran, I've always had anywhere between 15 to 25 plus trainers that were working for me at a time, and always the top three or five had that. They were teaching it. And what I saw from a leadership role was that you could just see that it was fun for clients.
Yeah,
and,
fun.
And as for trainers, you're always looking for that, right? You're always looking for ways to...
entertainment.
Right, to let your clients have... It's not just about education and all the time. Sometimes it's about them kind of letting off some steam and actually enjoying this session, and it's such a unique thing to do with them.
Yeah, it's highly, highly rewarding, but we mentioned this, and we're also going to be launching the online academy, but when we were shooting the videos the other day, we mentioned and talked about I don't think there's really any other tool in all of fitness that gives you that much of an intimate and kind of one-on-one experience with a client, because you're literally in there, you're sweating with them, you're working with them, like, you know, you're sitting there burning, you're not just sitting there on a clipboard writing down reps and whatever it is, you know, you're in there working with them, and that is something that you can't really replicate with any other tool.
So I want each of you to give me 1 to 2 attributes that you want, that you would want in that trainer, like that, to make them a badass coach / boxing trainer that you look for. And I'm sure each of you have 1 or 2 that are unique and different. I'm sure there's 5 or 10 that makes up a really good one. What comes to mind, each of you?
Like I said before, I love energy and personality. Like personality in a personal training, I think it's so important, and it's something you can't really teach, personality. You know, I feel like if you're a boring personal trainer, I mean, you guys can tell me better. If you're a boring personal trainer, it's going to be so hard to retain clients. Like, people want to have fun. They want to enjoy it so they'll come back, you know?
Yeah.
So if we can get a trainer who's got a great personality, who's fun, high energy, I mean, that's perfect.
Yeah, I'm right with Tony on that. I think that's the first thing that's going to help them retain clients, and then the knowledge is going to support that. So I'd say, along with personality, an eagerness to, or a willingness to learn and get better and advance the knowledge.
Growth mindset.
Forever.
Yeah.
You know, never get comfortable in your knowledge. Always keep trying to learn and grow and build. And if you've got that with personality, you'll smash it.
Yeah. I think genuine initiative and commitment to bettering yourself and always getting better, not being complacent as a trainer. And then also just a genuine passion and care for wanting to help people and actually make them better. Because you could be, a lot of personal trainers, and we see it all the time, are great salesmen. They can sell packages, but like, what's their retention though? They might sell a 10 pack because they made a great session, one session, but then are they retaining that
person? It's not a long-term plan.
You know, maybe you do for two or three packages, but are you training them 2 or 3 years down the road? And are they improving? You know, those people that are just strictly salesmen will be exposed eventually.
That's a good point, because one thing that I noticed, managing other trainers was, you would have your charismatic, outgoing trainers who did well. Mm-hmm. And then you'd have those other trainers a little more introverted, a little more quiet, but they also have a deep passion for wanting to help people.
Yeah.
So even though they don't have the same personality, they attract a different clientele and they would do just as well.
And long term, I think those people, personality is a huge part of it. You have to know how to communicate with people. You have to know how to find common ground. But you know, again, if you're just strictly a salesman and you're a hype man, you're a great personality, like, that person that may be a little bit more reserved but is a better trainer and is more genuine and about helping those people, long term they're going to make you more money.
Yeah.
I think they're more trustworthy as well.
Do you guys have the systems in place to actually measure this and check it out? Like, for example, you said 30 something trainers you have working for you right now. Mm-hmm. Can I see that, you know, Susie's got a 75% retention in her members that come to her class, and you know, Sal's, you know, got 90%? Like, do you guys have the ability to do that?
We don't have the analytics per se. Like, we don't have them it charted out. More so for the classes, like who's coming back and who's taking the classes. Mm-hmm. But you know, I look at the trainer invoices every week to see what clients they're working with. Do I recognize that name? Is it a new client? Was it a trial? Am I going to see that name? So it's more up here.
So
but we need to put that on paper.
And let me tell you, getting back to, you know, how we started this conversation with how it's very difficult to manage a large staff of trainers and getting everybody being creative, but yet focused on one goal. This is something in my career that's helped me out. I was always a numbers guy. So I used to love to, trainers would come in and they would be so nervous and scared to sell because I got into this for helping people. And you mean to tell me I got to sell? Like, that's just so to make that an easier process for them, I would help break it down for them mathematically so it didn't look the same. For example, like, we used to talk about, like, the average person can close at about 25%. So, I would actually go in and figure this out for each of my individual trainers on what their closing rate was. And so I would say, okay, if you talk to, and I would be able to figure this out individually, and this would be my one-on-ones that I'd have, and say, okay, it looks like, you know, you're closing at 17%. So let's work that backwards. That means you need to talk to, you know, 75 people. We know that if you talk to 75 people, half of those people will show up to your class. We know that if half those people show up to your class, that 30% of them will potentially enroll with you, and then 17% of those you actually close on a package. So instead of worrying about the sale and the closing, let's just work on you getting to X amount of people and focus on that number instead of stressing yourself about your sales skills, because that will come and develop as you go over time. Yeah. This helps you guide and lead them in the direction that you want with purpose. And when you're breaking it down really simple like that for them.
Did you do all that manually?
I did.
Yeah.
Great. I think that's an amazing approach. It's really good. A big thing for us is, I mean, without, you know, breaking it down number wise, but every trainer that comes into work for us knows those classes, that's their platform to kind of show who they are, what they do as a trainer.
It's a representation of them.
You know, how genuine are they in their approach and how much they really want to help people. The trainers that don't take that seriously and don't believe and buy into that, they're not going to have many clients. The trainers that really believe that and put their best foot forward every single class and know how to switch it on and aren't just working the 60 minutes. They're working 10 minutes before, talking to people, socializing. They're working 10 minutes after, you know, just giving people tips and showing them drills or whatever to fix things. Those people alone are definitely the ones that are going to for sure be the most successful at our gym.
We were talking about passion and having the passion, and that's one of the key attributes of finding a successful trainer. Do you think that is something that someone's born with, or do you think that's something that you train?
Well, I think passion in general. There's a book one of my mentors told me about. I can't remember the name of it, but like, can you teach passion? Like, do you think, is it just inherent, or can you really develop passion and motivation? Can you motivate people? I think for the most part, you're either motivated or you're not. Mm. You either have the habits and the work ethics to make yourself successful across any platform, or you don't. Mm. I really believe
how you do anything is how you do everything.
Yeah, yeah. I used to sometimes I think that's the natural inclination to believe that, and I think we've experienced more often than not that seems to be the case. Mm-hmm. But I've also had experiences, not many, but I've had them, where people came to me and they didn't seem to have the passion because of circumstances.
Yeah.
And then once I've eliminated some of those circumstances or gave them an opportunity, mm-hmm. then the passion.
Can you give me an example?
Yeah. So I hired a guy years ago who actually, good friend of ours, who had applied somewhere else, didn't get hired, came to see me, applied, and we started talking, and I liked him. There was something I liked about him, but he'll tell the story better himself, that he didn't really feel he had this potential to do great things, and that when he came to work for me, I showed him that he could do these great things, and he felt like he could trust me, and then the guy just fucking blew up, and he became one of the top managers that the company had ever seen. And I think it was just giving him that opportunity.
Yeah. Is that passion though? Or is that you just gave him the opportunity and then he developed.
That's a good point.
He developed confidence, but that passion I think was there. He just didn't have a platform.
Yeah. Who are you talking about? That's Larry.
That guy's very passionate. Yeah. He's passionate about sports and everything else. Yeah. You gave him the confidence in something that he was less confident about. So it's just like, I believe anybody that's probably in this room right now, I could probably throw a subject or a career or a job out there that none of you have done before. You'd be like, fuck, I don't know what I'm doing. But if I built the confidence in you that, hey, you can do this, I'll teach you how to do this, you're all passionate guys, you'd probably fucking figure it out and be successful.
It's finding what you like and what you love too. That's what's going to bring that passion out. You know, you can throw somebody in a job that they don't like and they have no interest in it and be frustrated why they're not showing passion. Well, it's because they're not loving it. But then you think, oh, that person's not a passionate person.
Are they performing though? Or they may not be passionate about it, but are they performing? Because they can't, if they don't perform, they can't just leave that job, go get another job, and all of a sudden turn
they can still perform without passion. I think I'd say the vast majority of people that are working office 9-to-5 jobs are doing
necessity.
That.
Yeah,
I don't think that passion is necessary. I think it makes our job as leaders a lot easier when you have passionate people. This is, again, why I'm such a numbers guy, because my and it took me a long time to figure this out, because I used to look at my staff and I would say, you know, I'd have my superstar fitness director or trainer that, you know, I want everyone to be like him. But the fact is, there is nobody else like you.
It's not going
to
happen.
And I need to stop doing that. I need to start looking at this more like a football team, and that I've got a quarterback, I've got a wide receiver. Yeah. Even though they're all doing the same job, 100%. They really are different and unique for the company.
Yeah.
And so then I need to learn how to get the most out of each one of them. And for me, nothing was easier than showing them that way with numbers and analytics to break it down. So I could look and see like all of their different strengths. Like maybe you guys have somebody who fills classes really, really well, but closes like shit because they just don't have that charisma or passion to sell, right? But then they're really good about going out and getting leads to drive into the club. But then I have this other guy or girl who is lazy as fuck, never goes out, gets new leads, never drives more people into my gym, but man, put one or two people in front of them and he will close the shit out of them.
Yeah.
So then I would piece these two together and I would motivate the one that was already passionate, loved going out and getting leads and bringing people in, to continue to do that more. Because one of my favorite things to tell people is stop focusing on the things you're not good at, focus on what you're good at and be great at it.
Exactly.
So if you're already good at going out and doing that, I'm not going to waste my time trying to make you a better closer because you already suck at it. You know you suck at it. You're discouraged about it. You know you're good at this. I'm going to keep pushing you to keep doing what you're good at and be great at it. And then I'm going to work on the guy who's already that loves sales and good at it, and I'm going to make him even better. Not only at selling for himself, but maybe even helping others on my team and doing that. So
how do you manage that? I won't want to call it double standard in a sense. I agree with you. You have to make people be great at what they're already good at. But if that person that's bringing if that person's the one bringing all the people in, but this is the guy that's closing and he's not bringing the people in, like we've dealt with that a little bit. It's like, you know, some people are selling, but they don't really necessarily perform and execute the way they should in the class. But then you got someone else that executes and is just amazing and all star in the classes. But then you kind of got that they're one's earning more but with less effort. Like, how do you manage that?
By the way, Doug, you need to cut that clip out, what he's just done there, because it was fucking great, yeah, by the way. What you've just said was really motivating.
Well, yeah. This gets my juices flowing when we talk like this, because this is what I loved about leadership, because it ain't fucking easy.
Right. Yeah.
It's not easy.
I was going to make that point right after you said that it takes talent to be able to do what you're saying to do.
Fuck yeah.
To be able to recognize talent in other people, you need to have talent to spot that yourself and then use that to the strengths. You know, it's not always easy and it's not cut and dry. Like, oh, he sucks at this. Oh, well, yeah. Fuck him.
Yeah, no.
It's like, okay, well, he sucks at that. What is he good at? And then it requires talent to find out what he's good at and then make him realize that he's good at that thing as well. Because he might not realize, or she might not realize that they're good at that.
I shared this on our podcast probably a couple times now, because people have asked us like some of the most like paradigm shattering moments or best advice that ever was given to you. And I tell this story about a time when I was probably 22, 23 years old. I just got into management and leadership. And my partner, who was a GM at the club, came in, and I remember I was working on all this paperwork shit because I was not an organized person. That's not what I was good at. I was good at leading people, and I just smashed goal. And in my head, I was all proud of myself. My boss was coming in, the district level guy was coming in to come see me, and I thought he was going to come in and tell me fucking how great I was because I just killed it, right? And he came in and told me everything that I was doing wrong and picked apart, you know, oh, you're not doing your paperwork here and your files can be better, this, that. And it just totally fucking discouraged me. But I'm also a passionate, motivated guy. So what did I do? I sat down at my desk and I'm doing the paperwork like I'm getting good at this. And my buddy, or someone who became my buddy later at this time, my GM, comes over and he fucking whack, knocks it all off the desk. He goes, what are you doing? And I'm like, bro, I have to work on this. Boss came in, said all these things. He's like, listen, you're 20-something years old. You're in a position of leadership for a reason. Okay, you've got qualities about you that are very, very special. This isn't one of them. Mm. Stop focusing on what you're not good at. Mm-hmm. Focus on what you're good at and be fucking great.
Right.
And it was like, boom, this like light bulb went off. And when you think about that, those people are going to be, these employees are going to be so much more motivated to do the things they're already good at.
Yep.
Which as a leader, you want to drive and you want to push that. You start focusing on the things that they're not good at and you put a lot of energy that way, you're only going to discourage them.
We had a conversation the other day about what creates job satisfaction. Is it money or is it the fact that you're providing value within your job?
Well, most management, right? like we are saying, most...
Some are different, right?
Mm-hmm. The psychologies of management and how to manage people is going to tell you, no, the biggest motivating factor is having some sort of sense of value that what they're doing, that their work is important and mm-hmm. it brings value to the business. Not necessarily the money.
Mm-hmm.
Like any article, any book you read about managing people is going to tell, I mean, sure, money's important as long as they're comfortable, but like...
But I guarantee, we're saying value, and I agree with you, but the people that we're thinking about and talking about would probably turn around and say money, well, even though they don't realize that it's
different.
Probably
everyone
value.
Everyone is different.
Sure. Everybody's You're, different, but yeah. I'm saying the majority of people will instinctively say money when if you could... talk to them for 20 minutes and you'd probably
you'd
get
be surprised. Sal brings up a really good point. He's brought this up on the show many a times, that you'll see some of the most motivated, passionate people about something work for nonprofits.
Yeah. Charity.
Yeah, but let's not say nonprofits don't make money though. They you can certainly make good money.
Well, I'm talking about volunteers.
Yeah.
If you've ever worked with a volunteer who's feeding the homeless or saving, you know, the manatee or whatever,
because they're buying into a vision and everybody's purpose. And it's really like the culture.
Comes as well eventually if you're doing something that you just really care about and want to make an impact. If you do it and you do it great, eventually the money will come. I'd imagine not always, but again, if most people, you said something, most people's instinct is to say money.
Mm-hmm.
That's their instinct.
Yeah,
just let them chase that money, but are they ever going to find that happiness in reality? Like, they can buy as many I love tangible things, I love buying nice things, but like we all know that that's not what happiness comes down.
But I think if you haven't got money, money is the motivator. But when you're in the position now that we're comfortable, mm-hmm. money's not motivating us mm-hmm. anymore.
Mm-hmm. I tell you what, you take an employee that did a good job and you take them in front of everybody, in front of the whole staff, and you talk about how great of a job they did and how awesome mm-hmm. they are. Yeah. That's worth more.
Way more powerful.
That's
than
worth
money.
More than money many times.
Yeah.
A lot of you can. Sometimes you can give someone money, kind of, you know, show it's on their paycheck, nobody else knows, and they're mm-hmm. almost like... But nobody knows. Like, it actually, you know, praising people in front of other people, Very powerful. Very, very powerful. Mm-hmm. Don't underestimate it.
Yeah, like, right. I think Kev hit the nail on the head when he said, if you are concerned with like being the best and being passionate and giving everything to what you do in your craft, the money will eventually come.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, because you guys have two locations up now, mm-hmm. and you're all in one or the other, mm-hmm. you've got this great culture. You know, mm-hmm. they're all kicking ass because you, as the leaders, really believe in what you're doing and you love what you're doing. The challenge is going to be when you open 3, 4, 5, 6, and now you guys aren't in there.
Yeah, yeah. How you challenge replicate with two that. Gyms already. It's a challenge. Yeah. Because look, we are, like Glenn or Tony said in the beginning, we have 4 to 7 trainers in a class. So we already have a lot more trainers than, say, right. SoulCycle or Orange Theory or any of those studios. So we have more people to manage just by default because of how we run our classes. So we've run into that problem with two gyms. So, you know, what we have to do is really develop leaders that when they go, when we're ready to open a third gym, we take those leaders and plant them there in that gym. And then they understand the whole dynamic of what it means.
And that kind of comes back to what we said at the beginning, what Alan Cosgrove was telling us about the systems. Mm-hmm. For that to happen, we need the systems in place. Yes. Or me and him will be working our asses off trying to do this.
That's
shit.
For sure.
Well, the biggest challenge you're going to have with that is the buy-in from those people, from your trainers.
Right. Yeah.
Because there's going to be pushback. The more systems that you put in place. Yeah,
going corporate.
Right. Exactly.
Sellouts.
And so as a forward-thinking leader, I have to kind of think already like, okay, I know that these are necessary. You know, all the smart people tell me, all the millionaires that have done this before me are like, listen, if you're going to do this, you need to be more organized. You need to have it like this. You need to have these systems in place. So you know that what will make and separate you guys from everybody else is being able to take that bit of information and then now implement it into your guys's clubs, but then also doing that without disrupting this amazing culture that you've already proven and built mm-hmm. to be successful because you're wanting to duplicate it. So that is definitely it's challenging as fuck. Nobody knows that better than you guys because you guys are in it.
It sounds like that's one of the hallmarks of your guys's clubs is the how many trainers are in each class.
Right.
Why did you guys design it that way? What is it that they provide? That is it because
you said 7 in a class?
Yeah,
I didn't know that.
Class of 36 will have 7 trainers.
It comes back to the intimacy of the mitwork.
That's exactly it.
That's the main attraction of the classes and the people are getting that one-on-one attention in a group class.
And that's
you can't really get that anywhere else.
We are different. I mean, not only anywhere else, but any other boxing studio in particular.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've never heard of that.
Yeah, you're gonna have one trainer. With 30 heavy bags, the trainer's gonna be telling you hit the bag faster, harder, do some burpees, come back up, hit the bag more.
That's most gyms, not
No, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like most other gyms are gonna have that, any boxing studio, but because we have that intimacy in the rings, we have such a good ratio of trainers to
yeah. Now you walk in, we got a trainer will approach you, wrap your hands like a real boxer. You know when you're first coming in, and then you're getting that one-on-one time. You're learning real boxing technique, like rather than the one trainer screaming at you to punch your bag harder and faster. Mm. You know, there's these boxing gyms are popping up every. I don't know around here, but in where we are, popping up all over. Now, kind of think that's seeing this humbly, like. Because they've seen the success of we're doing. Wow, that boxing gym's smashing it. It's everywhere. We need to open a boxing gym. Mm. And then they do it all completely wrong. And then they get trainers who don't really know how to teach boxing, which is good for us because now all these companies are sending the trainers to us to get certified.
It's not a genuine boxing experience. But everybody wants to be the soul cycle of boxing. That's what we keep hearing. I don't know if we should name studios, but everybody wants now to be the SoulCycle, which is a great model, but you're not going to get that authentic boxing experience going into a place like SoulCycle.
Well, I was just going to say the big difference to me looks like it is a gym operated by real boxers.
We actually learn real skills.
Well, I was going to say you guys actually value the skill and the sport behind it versus somebody who's opening it up and saying, it's just a workout.
Yeah.
Let's just get you to sweat. Let's just get you to hit the bag. Yeah. Like, you guys are technicians.
Just do jumping jacks in the sauna. You know what I mean? Like, save the money.
We've had a lot of success with taking old boxers and making them trainers by showing them the personal training side, the mechanics, the body, nutrition. And then we've also had a lot of success, especially with the academy, taking personal trainers and teaching them the boxing. But those boxing methods are founded in real boxing techniques. And that's another thing that's really exciting about the academy is we're developing this curriculum. So when we do decide to expand and open, multiple other gyms, it's a hard job to find trainers that do what we do. Mm-hmm. You know, you either have to take a boxer and teach them how to be a trainer, take a trainer and teach them how to do the boxing. But now that we're going to have this curriculum, it's going to make, it's going to give us the system, the skeleton for building and making the trainers, you know, to go. So,
so you don't have to necessarily look just for trainers. You can actually open this up as like a formula that, that somebody that's really passionate about boxing or whatever, you can really take them through the course and the education of it to get
so level one, level two. We're going to have a whole curriculum of courses.
A question for you boys. What do you think the answer would be? What would be better to do? Get an old boxer and teach him the training, or get a trainer and teach them boxing?
Trainer teach them boxing
all day.
Not it's like it is 50-50
That would be my guess.
You get some
coming from trainers.
I'm sure you used to work with trainers, you know, you get some really uncoordinated trainers who are fucking useless. Get these trainers you can for instance, you can get a NASAM certification by sitting on a computer and being able to take tests.
Let me correct. I'll tell you why
that was a quick response.
I'll tell you why we all said trainers. When you said a trainer turning into a boxer, what I envisioned, and I'm sure these guys, you guys can probably echo it, is I envisioned someone who's already a successful trainer who wants to teach boxing.
Yeah, exactly.
That's why I said trainer.
Yeah. Yeah.
But if you're just taking a certified trainer who's just a certified trainer versus just a pro boxer.
Well, you can just then, like, because an athlete versus like a coach, you know, like there's a big discrepancy there.
80% of those trainers end up being failures already as trainers. So they're probably not going to, if you're not going to be a good trainer, you're not going to make it. I think you have to be a good trainer first before you could even be a good boxing coach. So I think
big time,
because I think you have to have those attributes, the empathy, the motivation, like growth minded.
We found people who've boxed at world level, world champions, have tried to teach boxing to somebody who's never boxed before, and they've got
they haven't got
a clue how to even begin words
to articulate it, right?
Because they've done it for years and years since they were kids and got to a high level, great, but that doesn't mean that you know how to convey what you did to somebody who doesn't know anything about it.
Yeah, well, it's like if you asked an astrophysicist to tell you how the universe or whatever it is, they're gonna sit there and like talk to Neil deGrasse. He's one guy that can break it down pretty simple, but it's like, they're going to be speaking a different language.
Yeah.
So that's what I think. That's similar to what you're talking about. You've had world WBC world champions. First two punches, they try to teach someone's a body shot and an uppercut.
Yeah.
It's like,
I want to know what you guys. Hopefully, you guys will be open enough to share this on this podcast, because I think that I like to get into the business talk with you guys. I think you guys are in an awesome business right now and with an incredible idea, and you guys are incredible dudes, and watching you guys grow it. And I know, being somebody building a business too, all the things that go behind the scene and the conversations that happen. I would love to know, what is your guys' greatest debate right now amongst each other, or that you argue about, like as far as direction or focus? Like what comes to mind?
Takes, like the priority right now?
What comes to mind to me right away? And you can tell me if
I'm impatient. I just want to hire like the most talented people ever. And I'm like, we're at the point now where we've got a reputation and a brand. I'm like, let's just get fucking stud trainers. And it's like, we've got to go through the system.
Well, that's a good idea, Glenn.
I'm just so impatient.
Sure. We're all on board with that. Like, of course we want that.
But like, you two are way more patient about it than I am. Like, you two are like, oh, we'll get this guy in and we'll spend some time with him and do the workshops. And I'm just
Think about the last year. I mean, you guys don't necessarily know, but just between us, think about over the last year, 2 years, the most talented trainers that we've brought in from day one, where are they now?
Exactly. And that's what goes back to what you said.
Right, they're off doing their own thing because they're an A.
And they're like, yeah, exactly.
They're an A. They're like, you know what? I'm going to do a box and burning gym. I'm just going to add an ING on this motherfucker.
I would argue to say that it's not a terrible thing, and Tony and I have talked about this, to say maybe not people that are A's from the beginning, but people you develop into A's, and then they go out and branch out and do their own thing.
Yeah.
I know Tony really is like dislikes it, but to me it's like it's a rewarding thing. And like, look, if you're that what do you call it in Silicon Valley, the where you house their nest or whatever. What's it called?
Oh, incubator.
Incubator. Yeah. If you're the incubator of all this great talent, people are going to want to come and work for you.
No.
You may go out, you may be creating your own competition, but like they're going to know, hey, that I want to get better. That's the place to go.
That's true. Yeah. Good relationships and good training. But
the reason why I dislike that is because we put time, energy, effort, building relationships up with these guys and
giving out opportunities.
Yeah, and giving them like helping them create their own brand when they're doing absolutely nothing before. They're in fitness, but then we bring them in, we teach them everything.
Yeah,
come friends with them, and then oh, I'm leaving. I'm going to do my own thing.
But I bet, like, I bet you they all failed, though.
Well, it depends. Yeah. I think it's case by case. It depends how people leave and what they do after. I think a lot of people have a hard time being 100% transparent and honest and upfront and saying, look, I want to go and do my own thing.
Right.
Yeah. I value everything that you've given me and approach it in that respect, you know, being honest and upfront, you'd get way further. You'd still have that relationship behind you going into whatever you're doing. But people have a real fear about being open and honest like that, and they'll tell you something else. And you're like, oh, shit. And then it appears weeks and months down the line that they're not doing what they told you. And you're like, what the fuck? You know what I mean? It's like
another reality we have to kind of just come to grips with is we are in the fitness industry. How many people are trainers for 30 years?
Right.
Most people use trainer. They're a trainer. Like you all were all trainers, right? How much training do you do now?
Yeah. Oh,
like God. Nobody's a personal trainer for life.
Mm.
Not a very few.
Yeah,
very few.
That's
probably
true.
Less than 1% of all personal trainers train for more than 20 plus years.
That's the nature of
Simmons.
The beast.
Yeah. It's just there's the turnover. It's just like waiters and waitresses. Like there's just turnover. It's just gonna happen. It's
but
just
what,
the nature of
what
it.
What you were saying though is, I mean, we experience all the time. You bring people on, train and develop them. They think it's easy because they don't realize all the work that goes into
they're
doing
getting them. Fed all
and,
day.
And they're like, oh, I'm going to go open my own personal training studio.
Yeah.
And I would tell these people, like, you're not going to succeed. Like, if you aren't the absolute best trainer in this entire company, you're not going to – there's no way you can make it on your own because it's 10 million times harder.
Even if they are the best trainer, they may not have the other assets and attributes
even then,
it takes.
Right.
Yeah.
I've been with these two since day one, right before the gym even opened. And the amount of times I've been asked, like, why do you want to start your own gym or your own box and burn gym? Or you know, I'm like, nope.
I see all the work and stress.
Exactly. I've seen what they've gone through for the last, you know, 5-6 years. And I'm like, you know, more power to you.
Another thing that's frustrating, we had a guy a couple of months ago. We trained him. He had no boxing experience. We trained him up and he was telling us, oh, this is the last job I want. I fucking love it here. It's great and all that. And we put him on classes and he was doing really well. We put so much time, energy, money into him. And then one day, no, I'm not making enough money. I'll quit.
Oh,
and I was
like,
fuck. Fuck. Cunt.
The
guy from England.
You know what? It's going to happen. It's going to happen.
That was where you made your mistake. No, I'm
it's going
to get into this with him.
It's going to happen to you guys. And the better you guys become, the more often it's going to happen. Let's be honest. The better leaders you become.
It's a good problem to have.
It is a good problem. And here's the way you have to look at it and the attitude you have to have, because you're right. There's going to be quite a few of them that do that. And inside you're like, you know what? Fuck that motherfucker. But you can't have that attitude because you know what? It's going to take.
You always got to look for
your
talent.
Eye off the ball.
Well, it's also all it takes. Could think of it this way: if you're dealing with all these A players, okay, these are higher echelon guys and girls that you are meeting that, you know, get some development underneath you, take that, and then continue to rise up doing their own thing or whatever. You know, you keep a good relationship, and this is why I always say your true net worth is your net circle, is they're still part of your circle. You do a good job of, and I still to this day mentor many trainers that have worked for me years and years ago. And the way I look at it is this, like if I'm really good to them, and I don't do it with the intentions of getting something in return, I'm just telling you this is what's happened in my experience, is that guy or girl that goes on 5-10 years later and makes it huge, you know, one of those will end up giving credit back to you or potentially be able to give you a hand. Some, I mean, you guys know we're in this business now of the virtual world and social media and email lists and all that shit. Like, how great would it be that, this guy was with, you know, say I come work for you guys, I fucking blow it out the water, making all kinds of money, and then I'm like, hey, guys, I'm going to go do my own thing. Maybe I do the boxing thing for a while. Maybe go find TV. Who fucking knows what I do? But I get huge. And I'm still in good relations with you guys.
That's what it's all about.
Right, to do a favor for you. Yeah, no big deal. You want me to email or tell my people or give you a shout out? I mean, so.
Mm-hmm. Like Kev said before, question for you boys, is like no one wants to be a trainer for 30 years. If this is not their career goal, how do you keep them motivated?
Well, we came back to that conversation. Are we gonna motivate them? Are we gonna keep them motivated? Or are they just inherently motivated people?
And it's going to be individual for each. But what I loved, let me tell you what I loved about your guys' facility more than anything else, and the knock I have on the Orange Theories, the Soul Cycles, all these other things, because think about all those class settings, and you, including you guys, it attracts the similar type of person, right? A trainer, a motivator, somebody like that. So we can agree on that. So you guys all kind of get that. But what you guys offer that I think is unique, and the nice piece is it does allow them to have their own little private business where they can train clients 101.
Yeah. And they can build the hell out of that.
Yeah, and they can build the hell out of that. And I feel like that is your that's your secret sauce to me. When I walked in and I saw your place, that was what was most impressive to me. Yeah. The way my brain works, I went like, oh, because that is the biggest challenge. I've been somebody who's ran big boxes. I've had small facilities like Orange Theories. I know what it's like to have those trainers in there. The ones that get great teacher classes, they do end up all. But if I had a place for them to privately train, because that's what most of them go do, is they know they can make, most of them leave because they make you a lot of money. And then they realize, oh my God, I could be making all this money for myself. Now, if you're helping them do that through their own private business that they have.
The problem with that is, and what we're seeing now as well, so that they're doing that great for a year, and then it's like, these are taking this percentage off me for this. I can be doing this show by myself in a different gym. But
then they don't have the platform. They don't have
I'm saying we see it happening. Yeah. So it's like, they're taking 40, 50% off us of our private training money. They shouldn't be doing, like, they don't get it, and then they're paying tax on top of that. So now we
have them listen to Mind Pump. We talk about this all the time, literally. That trainers leave these big box gyms or these other facilities that literally feed them opportunities and clients, and then they do the math. This is called trainer math. It's horrible math. I train 40 sessions a week. I make you know $50 an hour. I could be making the full session rate $90 an hour. Look how much money I could be making.
Right.
Even if I train 10 less clients, I'm still going to make this much money.
Right.
And then they go off on their own and they fail.
Yeah.
Because they fail miserably.
They initially have 10 clients.
Yeah. Initially, but then they fall off, and it's like, wait, how am I going to replace those people?
Exactly. Yeah. As soon as they get out, they're like, machine.
So apart from listening to Mind Pump, how can we tell them about that? Like, listen, you're going to feel like,
well, either that, or let's talk about how do you guys have that structured. I'm interested to hear the scale, because what I would do is, if I had a trainer who's performing really well in my classes and he's driving a lot of revenue, or her driving a lot of revenue to my business, and then in addition to that, they're also private training, I would create some sort of a pay scale that's structured that encourages them to be good at those things, because I'm going to pay you more money over here for being...
Which was something we've talked about. But before we go, I want to go back for a minute. You mentioned that trainer that we invested all this time in.
Yeah.
And something that we've gotten a lot better at, and I'm sure you guys can relate to this, but if we really paid attention, there's some telltale signs along the ways where we kind of could, if we really paid attention and we picked those up, we could kind of see the direction this guy was going. Mm. Same with the other, should I say German guy? We knew, this is another trainer of ours that we had that left. But like, we knew from almost day one, if we had just listened, if we had just saw them. And like,
hey, me and him are US citizens now, by the way, so we can say
it's a hard thing to like listen to those signs that you see and say, okay, let's just cut it off now. Let's just cut the umbilical cord and get rid of them. And so that's a really, really hard thing to do, because again, we're a gym that needs a lot of trainers. So it's like, how do we just cut these people off?
You replace them first. That's what you do. Well, if I had a staff and I saw some problems with some potential problems, even though they were still doing good, in my mind, I'm already replacing them with someone else just in case. Worst case scenario, I got another good employee.
And then to answer your point, Tony, what you asked about how do you discourage them from thinking the grass is greener on the other side? My question to somebody who's thinking about doing that would be, well, do you have a good following? Are you really good at marketing? Are you good at promoting yourself? Are you on top of your social media and your email outreach and all this kind of shit? If you're not, then it's not an option. And a lot of trainers, like what we mentioned back at the beginning, aren't great at that kind of stuff. They're not marketing type brains.
They're just want to put the time and effort into
doing it. Exactly, and it's gonna take a lot of time and energy on the marketing side to be able to get that build and grow to where you were when you were inside the gym.
We just had an episode recently talking about tech and social media and when's it too early to start, blah, blah, blah. But you just said something that makes me want to ask you guys. Is this something you guys take into consideration when you hire someone's social media presence? Do you guys look at that?
No.
You don't?
No. Do you think we should? I mean, we look at it. I look at it to see if they're out with girls or whatever, like drinking all the time.
Well, do you know an example of your guys' business? So I like to always look at like other businesses that are similar to your model that may be using this strategy. Are you guys familiar with Barry's Boot Camps?
Yeah, sure.
So they use that.
SoulCycle would too, I'd imagine, right?
I don't know enough about SoulCycle to know. I do know Barry's Bootcamp. They are heavily into their trainers' social media.
Right.
Yes, yeah. And part that's part of your job description is posts and doing, and they actually spend time from the leadership side developing that.
We've spent a lot of time, or Tony spent a lot of time trying to build their skills and knowledge and awareness of how important that side of their jobs and their career is. You know, we've had speakers come in and say, you know, be on top of your shit with this stuff, do this, do that, giving, like, you know, practical tips on how they can grow their following and build their presence. And a lot of trainers that we deal with, they don't really jump on it and see the importance of it. They just kind of see it as, well, that's not really for me. I'm a trainer.
No, but if they come and apply and they already have.
Right, that's part of their job description.
It's huge.
They do this really well. A way that you guys can start to kind of implement that now, so it's not like totally rocking the boat. I know you guys got video guys that are kind of following you around more. I would, you know, schedule him. I'd pay him for a day where he's going to, on my busiest day of trainers and coaching, and he would be walking around taking great shots of my trainers teaching the classes. And then I would upload it into a Dropbox that all my trainers have access to. So now you're handing them good looking, high definition pictures of themselves teaching in your facility. Mm-hmm. And you can already, if you want to get to the next step, you can have a guy, if you have the funds to do this, a little bit of an investment, and then you brand it. You could put your Box and Burn logo, whatever, on it. But if it's a high resolution image of themselves, so where this comes from, this is part of our strategy. So we have guys like yourself who come in, and, you know, part of our teams, and we're actually putting together a actual packet for this. So real soon here, you know, fast forward a couple months, you guys would come here. Taylor would hand you guys a packet, and in the packet actually gives you a social media strategy on how to use the photos and the videos I'm about to provide, all edited and done for you.
Right.
And how nice is that, right?
Yeah, class.
Right. I don't get to push you and say, hey, Tony, could you please post about me this week or that?
We're doing some of that in the academy.
In the level two academy, we do a big thing on social media marketing and helping trainers how to promote yourself. Of course, it is a massive thing. And it's so fucking frustrating to me, because I'm huge on social media, when trainers don't want to do that. Like, I've tried to set them up with our camera guy to get spotlight videos on them and about the career and about their life.
We offer to pay for it.
Yeah, we offer to pay for it. Yeah. I even set the time and the date, and then they'll cancel.
Oh, wow.
And it's like, what the fuck? Yeah. We've got, like, this many, like, tons of trainers, and they'll not do it. It's like...
Have you guys thought of other strategies as far? So I look at, you know, your business, and like, some things come to mind as far as scale is concerned. Like, you know, what we're talking about all here, it seems like great strategies for like a physical location and improving on the current status of where your business is. Have you guys thought of, like, you know, turning this more into like a licensing kind of a thing, where you're going to go into other gyms, you're going to teach their trainers how to implement your very specific class that you've systematized completely, and now they can implement that, and, you know, this is a brand that they pay to be a part of.
It's funny you should say that, because that's something we've been speaking about very recently, about an affiliate, because we're doing these academies and everyone's asked us about boxing classes. How do you do your class? How do you structure it? How many stations do you have? What do you do? So it's like, we can do an affiliate, and this is something you boys may be able to help us with, where we go into gyms. So you might have a gym, whatever it's called, and they might want to put a boxing class in there. We can put a Box and Burn class in there. Yeah. So it's not a Box and Burn gym.
Right.
But this
branded,
gym's got
a, it's an affiliate. Way you guys do
it's
everything.
An affiliate, and they pay us a monthly fee. And then they'll come and get the trainers.
I see a lot of opportunity.
I think that'd be a lot easier to scale, like Justin.
Oh, my God. Yeah. And then you want to talk about potential, like, you know, Body Pump and Tybo. And
Les Mills killed it. You guys should just go through that.
Yeah, that's huge.
Yeah, so this is something I'd love to talk to you about after, because I know you are all smart bastards. And you'd be able to help us with that.
one thing, speaking of the potential.
I don't know what you're talking
speaking
about.
The potential of that, I watched the 60 Minutes with the CrossFit guy, the guy that founded
Glassman. Glassman,
yeah. And in that, it mentions how he's made the majority of his money from lawsuits from people who've tried to start CrossFit gyms. So he's made a shitload of money from the CrossFit franchise, but then he's made even more money from suing people who've tried to do CrossFit and it's not part of his franchise.
Well, it's actually
It's like, what we're going to do is we're just going to go around the whole world, right? And if there's a boxing class in that gym, we're like, is this Box and Burn Trio? Is this part of the franchise? No, it's not. All right, see you in court.
You must have some really good attorneys.
Here's your son.
How do you say that you have specific ownership over
a technique,
how to do a squat in, with a clean. How do you? I don't know how to, you must have some really.
It would be the systems that you guys would do, right? That's what you would do.
You'd have to have your signature systems.
Yeah, you'd have
But even then, I feel like it would be really hard to enforce those. I mean, clearly it works if he's done it, but
yeah.
Going back to what you said before about the question about if the trainers are performing, can you reward them higher?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So another thing Kev done, it's absolutely amazing. I think it's even better than Kev thinks, is a tier system. Do you want to tell them about the tier system, how we do that, Kev?
Yeah, I mean, essentially, it's just it's you know, it determines your rate, what you make per class, and it ranges from, I guess we could say the amounts, it doesn't really matter, anywhere from $18 to $30 a class, depending on your tier, and then you can make anywhere from 40 to 60%, depending on your tier. And so there's other things involved, like once you get to tier two, there's a $500 bonus. Once you get to tier three, there's a $1,000 bonus. Just give them a little, but it's also volatile. It can go up and down. So it's based on performance. In leadership skills, but it's also based on your education, so your certifications, workshops, other things you do. Obviously, the education side of it is not going to be volatile. It's not going to move up or down too much unless you let your certification expire. But it holds you more accountable in the classes, and you know, as far as you know, showing leadership skills and performing and doing what you're supposed to be doing and what's to be expected. Every quarter, we have performance evaluations, and we bring them in. All the leaders will score the trainers they work with the most. And again, depending on their score, they can either go up or they can go down. And so it's just kind of something that they can keep in the back of their mind. Like every quarter, I have the opportunity to go up and tier.
And with the two things, the performance and the education, because you could have a very educated trainer who's not performing in classes, so he doesn't get rewarded for it. Or you'll get a guy who's really performing in classes, but his education's low, so he can always build up.
Has to be equally weighted. Mm-hmm. Like we value education a lot; it's super important, but we also value that performance very much. So we equally weight them, and so it's kind of it keeps
smart.
People
it's a very honest. Similar structure
that's smart. That's
to
what we had.
Yeah. 24 used to do the exact same thing for every certification. Used to bump up $3 per hour that you made, and then for the amount of hours of clients that you've trained, every time you hit a new mark, you got a new override bonus. So very, very similar. No, I think it's a very smart strategy.
It's great because you could have a guy who's got a degree in, you know, physiology or whatever, but it doesn't make him valuable to our gym.
Yeah.
You know, whereas a guy who knows the gym inside out, knows exactly how to execute a perfect class, knows all the members on first name terms, but his knowledge is still pretty, you know, he's still building his knowledge. You know, that's way more valuable to the team.
How often are you guys holding the certifications like you are in our place? How often are those happening?
I think we'll have done 12 this year.
Oh,
wow. Fantastic.
Yeah, and every single one sold out.
You're kidding me?
Yeah, we've got three left, yours and then two more. But yeah, they've all sold out. We've been to Denver, Vegas, that haven't sold out.
We actually have four
Austin.
More. Four
more. Oh, Phoenix next weekend.
Wow.
Phoenix next weekend. And then
Orlando.
Yeah, Orlando. We've been all over. And yeah, I mean, it's great. The response we're getting is fantastic, and the word's like spreading. We're in with Onnit. Onnit's helped promote us a lot as well. We've been to their place. We certified all the Onnit Academy trainers, who work down there. But yeah, I mean, it's picking up. And like I said, because boxing's getting more and more popular, but no one really knows how to teach it correctly. So when they search for someone to teach it, we either come up number one.
And speaking of systems, the academy, the certification course, it's not just like a one-day course, like, oh, here's how you teach boxing. It's like we're giving you an actual blueprint and a system so that if you get someone who comes to you and says, look, I want to learn how to box, I want to hit pads, it's like, okay, well, here's exactly how you're going to teach that person who's never boxed before. Every single time, you've got an exact science and system.
You guys are really tackling two mega monsters at one time when you think about it, like the building these brick and mortar gyms and operating them with 30 plus trainers and potentially adding more to that, also while building this incredible education system and certification system that you guys are building right now. Each of those are huge businesses by themselves.
A huge project that we're doing now, it's been ongoing for like 6 months, is putting the certification course online so people can learn at their own time. We're getting people from Australia, from India, from all around the world wanting to do the certification course. And now we can do it online, so they'll watch videos, then they'll submit videos to us, like how to wrap a handle, watch the wrap that, and then they answer questions on it. They'll submit a video to us, we'll say yes or no, they'll go on the next part of the
they have to answer questions as well. Yeah,
answer questions,
like, and per section they submit videos, we give feedback, but then after every video we'll have questions.
Yeah.
So
is the online certification the same as the in-person one? Yeah, they're weighted the same.
The curriculum's the same.
Yeah. It is. Yeah, it's exactly the same, but obviously in person is better. Mm. You know,
because you get like to it. Meet him.
Yeah.
Do you make it to all of them?
Yeah, I've been to every single. We've all been to every single
three
one.
Three of us teach every live course. Yeah.
Oh wow, you guys are handling.
You guys are fucking awesome. Dude.
Yeah, we love
it. I mean, it's something that actually, speaking of the tier system, we have implemented. Like, you reach that elite tier, the top tier. Now you can travel with us for the academies and help us teach them, because they've gone through the whole curriculum and they kind of know the system. But eventually we'd like to have enough trainers at the elite level where we can start to send them out. And it's fun. It's once you do it a few times, it becomes very easy, but you also get to travel to different cities, you know, go out to eat, you know, everything's paid for us. So it's a nice little incentive for them to kind of go.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah, that's another thing for them to what might motivate them, like, is yeah, you can travel with the academy. And I think the next level up from being a personal trainer is teaching other personal trainers what you're an expert at. So yeah, we're getting lots of success.
What kind of feedback have you guys been getting from trainers who've done your certifications in the past who are now just you know, utilizing it?
Like I said, a big one is retaining clients, because clients, if they've never boxed before, they wanna learn how to box, and then they're getting good at it, and then they want to get better, so they want to come back the next day and do it again, and then they want to come back the next day and do it again, as well as people earning more money through putting boxing programs into their facilities if they're a business owner.
So go ahead.
Not only retention, but also you're increasing your exposure to potential clients, because now you've opened several more doors to clients. Like before, you said, okay, this client wants to do personal training, fitness training, but they also want to box. I can't train that person. So now they've increased their exposure to who they can actually work with.
Well, walk us through October 7th here at Mind Pump Studios. What does that day look like for somebody who enrolls and comes to this class? How do you start the class? To walk me all the way through every step.
Yeah, so the first thing we do is talk about the importance of safety and hand wrapping. You know, you need to wrap your client's hands, because if you don't wrap your client's hands correctly and you try and teach them boxing, they're going to get injured.
So I'm assuming, do you guys provide wraps for everybody too? So
everyone,
you
have all the... Yeah, everyone gets a free pair of hand wraps. And then we teach them how to wrap hands correctly so your clients don't get injured. Because if your client get injured, they're not going to come back and train with you. You're not going to earn the money. So we do that. Then we go over a boxing-specific warm-up.
So you're going to make fun of me. Go ahead. It's fine, because I know I wasn't a fucking boxer. So because that, what you just said right there, I don't know how to wrap. So I used to make my clients get those gel inserts. How bad is that?
No, they're okay.
I approve. Yeah, they're not as good as hand wraps.
Sorry, you call me an asshole. It's all right. I'm not a trainer anymore. I don't do that shit. But
as well, when you're wrapping someone's hands, that gives you the opportunity to connect with them. You're holding their hand, you're wrapping them up, you can talk to them and
right.
You know, build out.
It's kind of cool too, let's be honest.
Yeah.
If I've never fought before and I'm sitting backwards on a chair and you're wrapping me up,
it gets me
hyped just thinking about it.
So you build that emotional relationship, and then they feel like badasses. Now they've got their wraps on, like, fuck, they feel legit. And then we go through a boxing specific warm up where Kevin or Glenn will take them through that. Then from there, we teach them how to box, because it's very important that you know how to box before you go ahead and try and teach it.
Right.
Like, it sounds so obvious, but nobody else does that.
Right, yeah. Yeah, you see these trainers, they think they know how to hold the mitts, but I'm going to... If you ask them, when you step left, why do you step with your left foot first? They've got no idea of the answer, you know? So we teach you how to box, and then we teach you how to shadow box and tell you the benefits of shadow boxing. Then we go into how to teach other people who's never boxed before. That's the main thing, like teaching someone who's never boxed before how to box. We've got the system down. You know, I was thinking the other day, we've taught people how to box over 25,000 people in the last five or six years. Like, we've figured out the best way to do this, and that's what we give them. It's like our trade secret, really, how to teach someone how to box who's never boxed before. We kind of did it with Justin when we were here before, but we break it down even more.
And today.
Was he a good student?
Come on, man.
No, he was.
Fucking guys. You know what? Kev had an ice pack on his shoulder. He never told you about that.
What a lot of people don't realize either is there's also, we were talking about this earlier outside the studio, there's a technique to holding pads too.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of trainers don't know that. They think it's just the teaching the boxing, but if you've ever held pads for someone and you don't know how to move with it and you get hurt. You end up hurting your wrists and your shoulders.
So skill and timing and technique involved to get good at it.
I've hit pads. I've been around boxing since I was 10 years old, forever, like over 23 years. I've hit pads with the best boxing trainers in the world you can think of. And I'm not just saying this, and I'm not blowing smoke up his arse, but Kev is better at holding mitts than anyone. I swear down he is. Than anyone I've ever trained with before. And like I say, I've worked with the best of the best Olympic trainers and all that. And then Kev goes over how to hold pads correctly, because it's about resistance, height, your balance, your stance.
Timing
is the big thing. And Kev breaks it down in such a way that makes it easy for you to be able to teach other people, you know, how to hold the mitts. And like I said, it's great when you hear that popping sound. Like you hit mitts with Kev today. You see how good it is.
Oh yeah,
made me feel good.
I had some power there.
Why am I the one without the headphones, man?
Once you get comfortable with that as well, then it's like, and we talk about this in the level 2 course, which is a little bit more advanced, but once you get to a certain point, there's a whole world of creativity with it all that just kind of opens up, like with just thinking about different combinations. And you know, once you start to really understand boxing, it just becomes limitless on where you can take it. And
that's a big thing that we see, is you don't have to have been a boxer to be able to teach boxing. You've got to understand it. Some of my boxing trainers who got me to be as successful as I was through boxing, Bobby Butte, my first boxing trainer, he'd never boxed a day in his life, and he coached me to be a European champion. Then from there, I went on to the Olympic world-class program. I trained for 8 years. It was an 8-year training program for the 2008 Olympics. The performance director was called Terry Edwards, the most successful amateur boxing coach of all time. Again, he'd never boxed a day in his life, but he understood how to box.
Wow, I did not know that. That's fascinating.
Amazing. And with that being said, we tell people that doesn't mean that you're going to leave here after October 7th and be able to start teaching Olympians, because you're not. But we give you the tools that you need to go out there and practice and work with to get better and better and better and start retaining your clients. And one more thing that we give everyone on the day is access to an online video library, because we learn a lot in one day. It's impossible to learn to be a great boxing instructor just after one day. You can be good. But we give you access to an exclusive video library with everything on
just
that we
to
teach.
Remember it too, because I'm sure, you learn it there, but even remembering the combos and all that.
You might be teaching a client and think, what did Kevin say about the resistance or the height of the boxing stance or whatever? You go to the video library and it's there, you know?
And it's good having that after, because I know what it's like doing certification courses, and it's like you get all inspired the day after and you're like, oh, I'm going to do this all week.
Oh, shit, what was that?
And then it kind of it drifts off a little bit. But if you've got that online library, it's like, oh, you can keep up on that excitement of it. But not only is it just teaching people to understand boxing fundamentals and understanding how it works, but we go into detail about how to coach it as well, you know, like positive reinforcement and just coaching basics and getting people to speed on that side.
So have you boxed before?
Mm-hmm. Very, very, very little. I have a little bit. I've hit pads, but it's been years, and it was for maybe 6 months at the most. So,
right.
Yeah.
He's our most athletic one.
Right.
Yeah. He's got the best 6-pack, aren't he?
Yeah, he does. I'm all show, no go.
He does.
But it's great to see in the fitness sphere, people like you guys succeeding for many reasons. Number one, you guys are great. You guys are great guys. But also because there's an integrity behind what you're doing. Many times in fitness, you see people teaching courses or classes or trainers who don't have integrity in their craft. And what I like about what you guys are doing is your certification is based on boxing. It's not based on workout. Not that that's a bad thing. That's a great thing, because the workout is a side effect, but you get the good technique. You get the fundamentals because it's taught by real actual boxers, which is that's the big difference.
It's very rare.
If I'm wrong, I think that's the big difference, right, between you guys.
Yeah, well, we teach, like you see, we teach real boxing. It's not just a workout. So we teach real boxing, and it goes a long, long way, because all these other fitness boxing classes are not doing that. You know, I went to one fitness class before, and they were teaching us a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 12. And I'm like, what the hell? Like, I went in, they didn't know who I was, I never boxed before. And the head trainer was terrible. And I was like, wow. I just wanted to see how other people do it. And this is a local place in Santa Monica. And I was like, wow.
Well, you know, I remember we used to teach it at, so when we worked for 24 Hour Fitness, God, this was, 10 years ago, they added a boxing class, and it was packed. Yeah. Packed. And I remember the first time I went and checked it out to see it being taught, and I was like, I know very little about boxing. I've had.
But you know enough to see
what's right. Bullshit. Like, so I've held pads for a couple of buddies of mine that boxed, and they've taught me some things here and there. And, you know, for about a year of my life, like, you know, 3-4 times a week, I was boxing and training with my buddy, but by no means do I know what the fuck I'm doing. But I know enough to know when somebody else doesn't know, knows less than me. Right. And so I would walk in this class, and I was like, oh my God, like this is the trainer now teaching all these people. Like, it's not about mechanics. None of things about, it's just about cardio. It's just about
the thing is,
cardio.
Even with that, the shit technique and all that, you'll still get a good workout. But if I walk into a gym and I want a personal trainer and I see Bob in the corner there teaching someone who just looks shit, then I see you over there, I see Glenn in the corner whose client looks really good, and I want to do boxing, I'm going to go and ask Glenn how much he charges.
Because he looks like he knows how to box.
Exactly. His client's looking good and looking sharp.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, because you said even if you have crappy boxing, you're going to get a good workout. However, just like with running, people will go run and they'll just be like, well, I don't care if I run good or not. I just want to sweat and whatever.
Yeah. And that's why there's people also, hate running, by the way.
That, I know that. That's the main reason why.
I hate running.
Well, you don't know how to run.
It right.
But with boxing, besides the fact that you're sweating or whatever, isn't the learning the technique properly, doesn't it give you more longevity as well? Isn't part of the technique rooted in being able to move your body in a way that's optimal?
Yeah, definitely. And then there's less chance you're going to get injured as well.
Right.
You know?
Right.
There's also a certain level of understanding. You got to know that, you know, when you're working with somebody, within 5 sessions, they're not going to be great boxers. You have to progress them and you have to move them forward and make sure that they're always learning new things. So, you know, just understanding that, you know, no one's ever going to have perfect form. Mm-hmm. Everyone can always have a better jab or better cross, whatever. You know, that's kind of a theme for us in our classes. We want to teach real boxing and real boxing technique, but at the same time, like, people are there to have fun and to get a great workout. But ultimately, are they going to be great boxers in the first week or two? No, it's not a sprint; it's a marathon kind of thing. So, if we have their commitment and we have, they have the understanding that they're going to come here, they're going to get a great workout, they're going to have fun, they're going to feel better after. They'll become good boxers over time.
And that's what we see. That them three things, like why people come back. The number one reason they come back to box and burn is because they have fun and they're enjoying it. The number two reason is it's a great, amazing workout. That's not the number one, that's number two. The number three reason is they learn to box. Now, if you try and teach them too much how to box, and that might take the fun out of it, because like he said, like, they're not going to be perfect. So if you
stand nice there balance,
for
a
full
huh?
hour trying to teach them how to perfect the jab, it's going to take the fun out of it, and they're not going to really want to box.
But if they're doing one thing, if they're doing something like where they're punching with their hands open, obviously you got to correct that, because they're going to end up getting injured. Like, you got to put a stop to things like that immediately. Yep. But as long as they're not doing anything that's going to really, you know, increase their exposure to injury, you know, and we're giving them the right techniques, we're reinforcing them over and over, we're holding them accountable, not many people are going to get that right away. Mm-hmm. But eventually, knowing we have some time.
Justin was punching hard today. What do you mean? You were punching hard today.
It was all right. He was making me sound like I was punching hard. Yeah.
Well, I was just going to make that point, actually. There's a skill. There's a skill to making people that who aren't very Kevin. Good look pretty good.
Thanks, man.
I could give you a hands-on later. Well, we should probably do like a little YouTube clip or something about this.
You hear that, Taylor? I want to do that. I want to shoot a video how to make a shitty boxer look good.
Okay.
And we'll use Sal as an example because it'd be perfect.
Yeah.
And then I'll go, all right, you feel good now, right? You look good. And then I'll show you like how it's like, no, it's just the trainer making you look good.
That's kind of a skill of it. You know?
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
Wow. So let's talk about October 7th here. We got you guys coming to youth. Three are coming to teach the class then.
Yeah, we'll be here.
Wow, that's fantastic. How does it work? What is the cost? I know you guys are going to have maybe a code or something.
Yeah, we're going to create a code for your listeners for 48 hours after this podcast's released. So you'll be like,
We'll give you the code in the intro when we record.
Yeah, I also believe that we could probably do a direct link, probably right to a landing page or something, where they can probably go straight into.
Yeah, we'll see.
So the price of the course, the one-day course, it's only $397, but with your code, they're going to get it for $297, which is a fucking bargain.
Ooh, nice.
You know? And then with that, they get the CAUs for NASAM, ASSA, AF, AFA. AFA, yeah. So they get to see who's fat, and then they get access to our online video library. They get a certified boxing t-shirt. They get the hand wraps. They get a notepad pen.
High-res photos from the day.
See, the thing is, right, it might sound crazy, but we're not doing this to make money, to get rich. We're doing it. Well, one, we love it, but we're doing it for the brand as well. Mm-hmm. But we absolutely love doing it. And the results that we're seeing, we're getting from people, I mean, it's great. Mm. Like that's why you see some courses is like $1,000. And our honors courses are like $1,100, mm-hmm. you know? And we charging like $300-$400. So, and our courses are fucking great as well.
Well, I think anything that's going to give your clients value is worth investing in. This is definitely one of those things. It's fun. It's different. And if you look like you know what you're doing and you're holding mitts for someone and you're in a gym, it's like a nice little commercial for you. Yeah. Right. You're probably going to get more clients.
And
as well.
I did say we're not doing it for money, but next year we're going to put the prices up. We're going to put up $100, so it's going to go to...
It is for money.
Next year it is. This year we've been...
You've exposed yourself.
$12 times. We haven't made a...
Keeping it real.
We haven't made a fucking penny.
$1,500.
So next year... Yeah,
the following year.
Next year we're going to get you.
Next year.
Hurry up, everybody.
Well, excellent. Well, I know you guys did some videos, so hopefully that'll be up by the time we air this episode, and that'll be up at our channel, Mind Pump TV on YouTube. And it's always a pleasure talking to you guys, man.
Thanks for having us on. Yeah, I really appreciate this.
Looking forward to October. We'll all be around here too, so I'm looking forward to that.
I want to take that class.
That'll be cool.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome.
Hook me up though.
Look forward to meeting everyone. And you can go to boxingburnacademy.com and find out more about it.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thanks, boys.
Thanks.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.